hackers hijack NPM packages with 2 billion weekly downloads in a supply chain attack. So, Nathan, to a non-technical person, can you explain what is an NPM package? Why is this significant?
Yep. So I guess, first of all, NPM stands for Node Package Manager. Mm-hmm. And a package is effectively a library or a program application written in, it could be any language. Node would obviously be JavaScript. There are package managers for other languages. So NPM is the repository that that stores all of these libraries that allow other developers, such as myself and Mark, to be able to use those libraries in our own projects. And it, you know, it's very, very common, very, very popular. You know, a lot of JavaScript development that you do relies heavily on Node and NPM for you to have all of the necessary code that you need to build the applications that you build. So it's a vast repository of code.
One of these background kind of pieces of software that you don't really think about, but is just kind of always there, like sort of a Cloudflare kind of thing?
Yeah, kind of. So, I mean, you'll often find that in a web-based program, there will be hundreds of these Node packages that will be form your application, and they will all have very specific jobs that they will do as part of that application. It could be something as simple as you have one library that generates charts, you have one library that generates tables, you have one library that focuses on inputs and outputs and button styling, and it could be anything. So you'll often have quite a lot of these packages that you will be using within your project.
So NPM packages have 2 billion weekly downloads. So Mark, what was this phishing attack? What happened?
So this was a very cleverly executed attack where a phisher decided to effectively scam the maintainer of this particular package with a kind of pretend sort of need to log in and change something on the NPM system, sort of very much simulating that. And of course, he responded, or she, in a very sort of, concerned way, did as he was told, and got through the hoops, inadvertently, of course, giving away his information to the hacker. The hacker was then able to take control of that package and immediately release a new updated version of the package, updated being the operative word here, with effectively spyware in it, and such that any user of that software downstream would have their software systems being monitored and information being passed across to the hacker, therefore collecting keystrokes and other things from the end user of software that's built upon that package. This is particularly frightening for us as developers, frankly, because, one of the security best practices is to keep your software up to date. And, you are aggressively nagged these days by automated systems to upgrade if there's a new release of something. So usually it's in your interest to do that, but it would have probably meant that people with our mindset would have almost immediately got that package as doctored by the hacker, and would have caused quite a lot of potential damage.
Yes, yeah, so 2 billion weekly downloads. So they targeted, so the phishing attackers targeted the providers of this software, created a fake update, and then messaged everyone saying, here's an update, but actually it had malware. So Nathan, as a software developer and you use NPM, would you have fallen for this, do you think?
I think it would be very difficult for any person using that package to know that there was a vulnerability in it. It would really be undetectable. As Mark said, there are mechanisms out there within NPM that, automatically ask you to update your packages when there are, updates ready. So, yeah, I mean, this kind of thing is, as Mark said, quite scary for developers. We host packages ourselves on NPM, so we need to be mindful of, emails that come in pretending to be from various places and, make sure that we ourselves don't fall for that.
Because it's not a case of an attacker impersonating the providers of the NPM packages. They actually sent out a legitimate...
Yeah, they were...
From the actual service themselves, but it was containing malware and spyware. So, Mark, what are your thoughts on this?
I mean, one of the things that I guess that slightly surprised me back to our first point today is that these days there's a lot of automated scanning that goes on using AI actually to detect these kind of spyware. So, I mean, in a way, the phisher was kind of lucky to, or very clever in the way they coded their update, that it wasn't picked up by automated detection systems, but it also maybe highlights a weakness with the NPM sort of system, that they're not doing as much of that sort of proactive scanning as they could do. But as I say, it is, you know, one of those things, as we always say, you know, and generally, you know, to people that we speak to, it's the social engineering scams that are the most effective.
Yeah.
And this is one of those examples where actually taking charge of somebody's account, becoming them effectively, is by far the most effective way to cause damage in that way. And actually attacking the software chain at a low level like that is one of the most effective you know, forms of attack. And we've seen it before. There was a very famous attack on British Airways that used a very similar sort of form of attack based on a library many years ago. And it's been a constant theme, one that we need to be increasingly aware of as an industry.
It's like there's a sort of XKCD comic which has, like, you know, like this balancing board of all modern infrastructure, you know, like all of big tech and government and everything. And then there's this tiny little stick that's like a piece of code called, you know, Klaus's number counter, which is maintained thanklessly by some guy in Sweden. Do you feel like that is part of the problem, Nathan?
Yeah, I mean, there are so many, you know, as I said earlier, so many packages. Just going back to kind of what Mark was saying, you know, I think one of the reasons why this may have gone undetected, or, you know, maybe taken longer to figure out, was it seemed like the package that was detected was used, or were used for kind of CLI based, so command line interface, where there is lots of typing going on, and there may already be, as part of a legitimate reason, some keystroke watching going on, so that, you know, the program can work properly. And so for the hacker to just insert a couple of lines that weren't additional keystroke, but they could piggyback on those, you know, would have helped them go undetected, I would feel.
Mark, is there anything that we can do to turn the tide on scams and fraud and phishing attacks?
Yeah. Well, I honestly think your biggest line of defence these days is training and keeping yourself up to date and being just very vigilant when it comes to responding to anything. We always say, when you receive a message, don't panic. Don't respond immediately. Take the time to look at it, check the information. There's usually something very obviously telling in a message. If you take a few seconds to look at the message, that often that may well be that it's come from an email address that looks suspect, that doesn't line up with the purported email address. If it's an email, we're obviously with phone related scams, there'll often be a link to click, which would be a link that doesn't line up with the official corporate link for that.
But then something like this situation site, where, you know, they've targeted a very, very intelligent, very technical community, and it looks completely legitimate. What is your advice? Let's say you download one of these packages. What would you do then?
Yeah, as a developer receiving this package, I mean, well, I think, you know, as we mentioned before, the challenge for us as developers is that the way that the system works is much more automated than that. So often what will happen is you will, you know, when we say we're told, we'll be notified automatically there's an update. We will typically just run all updates and maybe do some testing. And obviously, that, you know, if you're running best practices, you would run some tests against your software base having done the updates. But even those tests probably would this particular problem would have gone undetected with most testing you would have done, frankly. So there's very little you can do to mitigate downstream. And I think the focus needs to be on preventing these things from entering the ecosystem in the first place.
Mm. Nathan, anything we can do to turn the tide?
I mean, I feel like in my own personal life, I treat every email that I receive is being a scam or a spam. You know, and it's then I then look at it as, well, this is probably a scam, so can I prove
scam
that it's not a scam
until proven innocent?
Yes. And that's, you know, I get so many rubbish emails that's normally the way that I look at things nowadays, because, you know, in my day-to-day job I see a lot of scam and spam happening, and so my almost immediate reaction now is, this is probably a scam, until I can prove otherwise.
So is there anything we can do? You know, we all work for the Global Signal Exchange. What is the GSE doing to try and, you know, turn the tide, make the world a better place?
I think one thing that springs to mind is, you know, we're looking at AI and specific apps and tools to help people identify scam messages, scam emails and texts, you know, because they are almost impossible to recognise. AI does a very good job at finding things that you wouldn't normally see with your own eyes immediately. And so we are developing tools to help, you know, everybody understand when a message or an email could be malicious.
And Mark, kind of final thoughts on this topic. How can the GSE, you know, change things, make it easier to stop scammers?
Yeah, I think, I mean, the mission of the GSE is to reduce scams and fraud, and we do that through a number of different ways, and lots of that is about, you know, getting as much of the data about scams and fraud, in particular identifiers of fraud, to people as quickly as possible who can take action, and to have that action applied across the whole of the industry. I think, you know, to support Nathan's point, I think there's, you know, a lot more we are starting to do now to provide consumer reassurance. And I think that's a lot of it, is actually be able to provide tools so consumers can feel confident that the, you know, domain names or links they're being asked to click are valid. Linking in nicely with our first topic today, you know, what I think scams and frauds will ultimately undermine use of websites, you know, over time, as people start to lack confidence in clicking links and to going to, you know, websites. And I think that's a kind of, you know, that's another side of it, isn't it, that I think is important. And so the more we can do to instill confidence, you know, in consumers by providing them with good tooling to detect whether links are valid and they should be going there, then that will also help support, you know, the proliferation of the web going forward as well, I think.
Fantastic. Thanks, both of you. And just before we wrap up this topic, just some questions for you if you're listening or watching. Have you ever used NPM packages? Would you fall for a phishing attack? Or do you think it's always very obvious when a message is malicious?